Just quickly introduce our next guest talk by Dr. Richard Legret. He is a master's, and a master's in OT and is an executive director of WFOT. He's a clinical lead at dementia research in UK. He's formerly been associated with World Federation Occupational Therapist Program Coordinator as an international manager at Hays Healthcare, international manager at Reed Healthcare, student officer at Royal College of Occupational Therapists, and has authored many researches in the area of COVID-19. Today, his topic being valuing global collaboration.
Dear colleagues, my name is Richard Legret, the Executive Director for the World Federation of Occupational Therapists. It is an honour to be asked to participate in OTCON 2021. My sincere thanks to the organising committee for their hard work in putting together this exciting programme. Collaborative relationships benefit all levels of the profession, from people receiving or providing services to groups and organisations at the regional, national and international level. This presentation will outline how WFOT collaborates with a range of stakeholders, including non-government organisations, governments and regulators, educators and researchers, and civil society. WFOT is the global voice for occupational therapy and sets the standard for its practice. As a worldwide body, we represent the occupational therapy profession in the role of developing world health and well-being. WFOT was established in 1952 by 10 member organisations, including India. In 2021, we have 105 member organisations, 75 full members, 23 associate members, and 7 regional groups. We represent 580,000 occupational therapists globally, over 1,000 WFOT-approved education programmes, 63,000 occupational therapy assistants, and 100,000 occupational therapy students studying on approved programmes. Collaboration is defined as the situation of two or more people working together to create or achieve the same thing. As occupational therapists, we routinely collaborate with individuals, families, communities, groups, and organisations. National associations collaborate with governments, policymakers, state and regional representatives. Our collaborations often focus on occupational justice and the right for all people to engage in the occupations that they need to survive, define as meaningful, and that contribute positively to their own well-being and the well-being of their communities. WFOT collaborates with many different partners, individually and collectively, on initiatives that are relevant to the profession, address shared priorities, identify mutual goals, and involve planned strategy. Benefits of collaborative partnerships include increased opportunities, for example, funding and access, provide added value, the sharing of resources, and improve stakeholder engagement. Collaborative relationships, therefore, can result in optimal impact by achieving outcomes WFOT could not attain alone. WFOT collaborates with the profession in a number of ways, through its member organisations and delegates, individual members, occupational therapy experts and the profession, education providers, regulatory organisations, and national occupational therapy associations that are not yet members. WFOT's collaborations with the profession facilitate a range of outputs, including publications, repositories, education standards, online forums such as OCEAN, and the Occupational Narratives Database Project, the WFOT Congress, and World Occupational Therapy Day. WFOT collaborates with a range of organisations and groups to represent and advocate for occupational therapy and the profession. These include intergovernment organisations and agencies, such as the United Nations and World Health Organization, non-government organisations, such as Humanity and Inclusion, World Physiotherapy, and the Global Rehabilitation Alliance. We also work with government organisations, education providers, and civil society. As an organisation that represents the profession globally, it's helpful to understand the unique attributes of the WFOT that provide this international perspective. We are a federation of 105 national and regional occupational therapy associations worldwide. Through this, we provide credibility with a detailed knowledge and understanding of the occupational therapy profession in most cultures of the world through its member organizations. Through economies of scale, we can harness expertise and international perspectives on various subject areas whenever required. We facilitate global interaction and synergies through networking, marketing, research, international evidence-informed practice, and a World Congress. We provide the international repository and archive for the profession, and we coordinate the global and interactive media to celebrate the international profile of the profession. WFOT has a long-standing relationship with the World Health Organization and is formally recognized as an NGO by the United Nations. These organizations will only collaborate with official international organizations such as WFOT. WFOT has direct relationships with other international non-government organizations, often collaborating on specific projects of mutual interest and concern. We have a direct overview of international policy and directives that are mandated to WHO member states, meaning government organizations. We synthesize the delivery of occupational therapy services and education worldwide to establish global benchmarks that are both audited and reviewed. WFOT provides internationally accepted guidance and standards through position statements, education standards, and competencies. For the purpose of this presentation, I'm going to talk in more detail about WFOT and its collaboration with the World Health Organization and the United Nations. WFOT has been in official relations with the WHO since 1959 and with the UN since 1963. It is important to understand the context of the collaboration with the United Nations and World Health Organization. A focal point is the Sustainable Development Goals, which are a call for action by all countries from low to high income to promote prosperity while protecting the planet. They recognize that ending poverty must go hand in hand with strategies that build economic growth and address a range of social needs, including education, health, social protection, and job opportunities, while tackling climate change and environmental protection. All UN member states have agreed to try to achieve universal health coverage by 2030 as part of the Sustainable Development Goals and is a World Health Organization strategic priority. Universal health coverage means all people receive quality health services that meet their needs without being exposed to financial hardship in paying for the services. Universal health coverage is not just about health financing. It must address all components of the health system, including health service delivery processes, the health workforce, health facilities and networks, health technologies and communication systems, governance legislation and quality assurance mechanisms. Taking steps towards universal health coverage promotes equity, development priorities, social inclusion and cohesion. An integral component of WHO's work towards universal health coverage is the Rehabilitation 2030 initiative. Globally, one in three people today are estimated to be living with a health condition that benefits from rehabilitation. The Rehabilitation 2030 initiative highlights the importance of strengthening health systems to provide rehabilitation, emphasizing that rehabilitation is an essential health service and crucial for achieving universal health coverage. Rehabilitation should be available for all the population and through all stages of the life course. Efforts to strengthen rehabilitation should be directed towards supporting the health system as a whole and integrating rehabilitation into all levels of healthcare across the continuum of care. As part of the Rehabilitation 2030 initiative, WHO is developing a package of rehabilitation interventions for 20 health conditions to support planning, budgeting, and integrating rehabilitation interventions into health systems. WFOT provided nominees from expert occupational therapists to participate in the development and review of the rehabilitation interventions, and will work with WHO to disseminate the resources containing evidence-based rehabilitation interventions that will facilitate the integration of rehabilitation interventions in service delivery. A package of rehabilitation interventions will be available as an open access online resource and will have different target audiences for occupational therapy. Practitioners will be able to plan and implement specific rehabilitation interventions in their rehabilitation programs. Researchers will be able to identify rehabilitation research gaps. Academics will be able to develop curricula for the training of rehabilitation professionals. And ministries of health and other policymakers will be able to plan the integration of rehabilitation interventions in their national health services. The WHO Global Cooperation on Assistive Technology, known as GATE, has the goal to improve access to high-quality, affordable assistive products globally. To achieve this, the GATE initiative is focusing on five interlinked areas: people, policy, products, provision, and personnel. In relation to products, WHO launched the Priority Assistive Products List, which includes a list of 50 products selected on the basis of widespread need and impact on people's lives. Current work relates to standards and procurement for assistive products. WFOT has provided nominees of expert occupational therapists to develop standards in the areas such as wheelchair service provision and lower extremity prosthetics. WHO are developing an assistive products training package relating to the provision of simple assistive products. The training includes assessment and prescription, fitting and user training, follow-up, maintenance and repairs. The package will support countries in building the capacity for their community-level workforce. WFOT has served as an external reviewer for several of the online modules included in the training package, including modules relating to self-care, mobility, toilet and shower chairs. WFOT's collaboration with the World Health Organization covers a range of initiatives grouped into six areas, covering disability and rehabilitation, mental health, aging and life course, assistive technology, human resources, and the International Family of Classifications. Examples of projects and collaborations undertaken with WHO cover a range of different areas. For example, in mental health, we have provided input on human rights, competencies, and the Mental Health Action Plan. Working with the Human Resources Team on occupational therapy demographics, sustainability, and health service delivery models. With the Aging and Health Team on projects related to long-term conditions and age-friendly communities. With the Family of International Classifications on areas such as the ICF and ICD. And with the Disability and Rehabilitation Teams on the GATE Initiative and Rehabilitation 2030. This presentation has provided an overview of how collaboration within occupational therapy is undertaken at many different levels. At the core of our work remains the individual or community with whom we work. As occupational therapists, we recognise that collaboration is an essential part of our therapeutic relationship with anyone who wants to engage with us. In turn, occupational therapists work within a national system that is often supported and represented by a National Occupational Therapy Association. As a community of occupational therapists working in different regions, engagement also occurs within a regional context, informing and driving education, research and practice in response to areas of commonality and regional policy directives. Regional occupational therapy associations have an important role in supporting the profession at this level, and the All India Occupational Therapists Association is a member of the Asia Pacific Occupational Therapy Regional Group. Working internationally to lead and advocate for the profession globally is the responsibility of WFOT. We engage with expert occupational therapists from regions and national occupational therapy associations to support and inform policymakers at a health systems level, which often forms the basis of regional and national policy directives. We form an important part of our international occupational therapy community. The global context in which our profession collaborates includes a range of stakeholders and organisations, including non-government organisations, intergovernmental organisations and agencies, governments, education providers, and civil society. This concludes this brief presentation. For more information about the work of WFOT, I have provided some helpful references. I hope you enjoy Oticon 2021 and look forward to our continued collaborations.
If you have any questions, you'll have to connect with him directly over his email ID that he has provided, because this was a recorded presentation. So all the participants are requested to, for any further clarification, to get in touch with Mr. Richard. I would really thank him for lending his valuable time and video for this conference. Thank you so much. And we'll move on to the next session. Over to you, Soumyakanta.
Thank you, Sriva sir. Am I audible clearly?
You are, yes.
Okay, all right. So without wasting much of time, we'll quickly move to the next scientific session, which is scientific session 5. So the theme for the scientific session 5 is complementing neuropsychosocial diversity, occupational therapy perspective. So today we have with us to chair this session. The first chairperson is Dr. Amitabh Dwivedi. He is currently serving as Dean Jaipur Occupational Therapy College. He is also the PhD teacher and has a 15 years of experience in occupational therapy education and practice. His area of expertise includes but not limited to rehabilitation of persons with neurological, orthopedic, and developmental impairments. He is also an international certified wheelchair trainer. He's been serving as executive committee member of AIOTA since 2014. He's also the branch coordinator of AIOTA. He's been external examiner in various universities. He has numerous national and international publications into his name. He is also the recipient of 3 national and international awards for his contribution in the field of occupational therapy. To add on, he has also authored 3 books. I welcome Dr. Amitabh Dwivedi for this scientific session. Along with him, the next chairperson we have is Dr. Jagadishan D. He is MOT and MSc Psychology and PhD. He's also FAOT in Neurodevelopmental Research. He's currently serving as Principal College of Occupational Therapy, JKK Muniramaya Medical Research Foundation. He has 12 years of experience in PG teaching. He's also the volunteer for physical and occupational therapy treatment for children with hemophilia and Hemophilic Federation of India, 3CHI. Chapter since February 2000. He has served as convener and president for Tamil Nadu branch of AIOTA from 2010 to 2012. He is also the organizing secretary National Conference of AIOTA 2011 held in Chennai. He is also was the organizing secretary for the first level inter-college sports and cultural meet among Tamil Nadu occupational therapy colleges held in 2018. He is also the co-author of Theory of SIF Mechanism. He is a member of Curriculum Development Committee in Tamil Nadu, Dr. MGR in Medical University. He also developed curriculum for the BOT and MOP degree course from 2010 to 2014. He has developed the tool of Learning Disability Parent Rating Scale in the year 2018. I welcome both of you for this scientific session. Over to you, sir. So for this session, we have 8 papers. I would like to welcome both of the chairperson to further continue with the scientific sessions.
All the participants are requested to present for 10 minutes. Only 2 questions be asked per participant. A chairperson, can you please introduce each speaker with the title of the presentations? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the introduction. I welcome all the participants for the scientific session 5. With Dr. Amitabh Dwivedi, I would like to introduce, with the chair's permission, I call Dr. Shanaprava Mohakut to present the paper. He is presenting in the topic of functional performance and community reintegration of chronic post-stroke survivors in Eastern India.
Good afternoon, everybody. The topic of my presentation is functional performance and community reintegration of chronic post-stroke survivors in Eastern India. Coming to introduction, stroke is the second leading cause of death and first cause for functional incapacity for activities of daily living. Post-stroke individual cannot fully participate in the society. So it is an economical burden for the person and society. The future prediction projects the number of stroke patients will increase in alarming trend, outpacing the overall population growth. In developing countries like India, it will be 4/5 of all strokes across the world. As the onset age of stroke is decreasing and the magnitude is increasing, it becomes a great challenge in India. The rehabilitation of post-stroke survivor mostly emphasizes to make independent in performance of daily living activities. Whereas improvement of functional activities of post-stroke make independent in daily activities in the home environment, but cannot reintegrate or participate in the community. Hence, community reintegration is a neglected part of rehabilitation. According to ICF, occupation and participation is the central concept of health. Whereas community reintegration is the end stage of rehabilitation to achieve highest level of occupational performance and maintain a meaningful life in family and society. The literature says 40% of people with stroke return to work, whereas post-stroke survivor of Nigeria has better life satisfaction after community reintegration and is positively associated with community reintegration. In chronic stroke patients of Japan, clinical, functional, and occupational factors has impact on return to work and community participation. The neuropsychological factors also plays a big role in return to work for the post-stroke population of Netherlands. Obama et al. Found in their study there is a positive relationship persists between community reintegration to motor function and depression of post-stroke survivor of Southwest Nigeria. Previous study found the interrelationship between physical functioning and community reintegration and participation restriction in Ibadan. Hence, there is limited studies in India evaluated the community reintegration and the factors associated to it. Also, a little is known about the community reintegration of the chronic post-stroke survivor in Eastern India. With view of this, we hypothesize my study, community reintegration does have association with functional performance of chronic post-stroke survivors of Eastern India. The aim and objective of my study is to find the association of community reintegration with functional performance of chronic post-stroke survivors of Eastern India, to determine the interrelationship among functional performances, to compare community reintegration and functional performance of male and female chronic post-stroke survivor of Eastern India. The study was conducted in Neurology Department of Som Hospital, Bhubaneswar, and Department of Occupational Therapy, SB Netar, Odisha. Definition of population post-stroke survivor. The sample size was 94 and study was a prospective observational cohort study. Sampling method was consecutive randomized and inclusion criteria community dwelling post-stroke survivor of age group 30 to 65 years. Exclusion criteria, the patient having any comorbid condition like neurological diagnosis, multiple sclerosis, motor neuron disease, and orthopedic conditions. Psychiatric diseases like dementia, major depressive disorder, or psychotic disorder. The patient having severe cognitive impairment screened by MMSE, and aphasia and severe vision impairment are also excluded. Patients of alcohol or substance abuse also not included. Patients of recurrent stroke are also not included for the study. Instrument used for the study, minimal status examination for the screening purpose. For the outcome measure, community integration questionnaire, Lutton IADL, functional independence measure. Data is analyzed through SPSS version 20. General characteristics are analyzed by descriptive statistics. Spearman rank order correlation is used to find the association between community integration to functional ability and participation in instrumental activities of the stroke survivor, and also to find the interrelationship between functional ability to participation in IADL of the participant. Mann-Whitney U-test is used to compare the functional status, community reintegration, and participation in IADL between male and female. This is the socio-demographic table. Here, the table shows the male is 75.5%, whereas female is 24.5%. Mostly ischemic type of patients are included, and the mean age for the patient is 54.38, with standard deviation 12.06. This is the correlation table, where the correlation table shows that there is significant association persists between FIM and CIQ is the rho r is 0.565, and for lotamyidyl CIQ is the r is 0.687, and p value is less than 0.01. Similarly, intercorrelation between PIM2 LIDL is also significant, as the R is 0.532 and P is less than 0.01. This is the comparison between genders. And here, this table shows PIM, lotamyidyl and CIQ significantly better in male than female, and P is less than 0.05. Coming to the discussion, combinatorial integration of the one-year post-stroke participant is significantly positively associated with functional independence measure and participation in IADL. Also, functional independence measure has significant positive association with participation in IADL. A strong positive association present between functional independence, participation in IADL, and combinatorial integration. This may be those who are more independent in their functional ability are more physically able and have better motor recovery. Hence, they can use affected extremities and perform their basic daily activities by their own. The participation in IADL have more significance with community integration. This may be because to be independent in IADL, individual requires more complex cognitive component. For community integration, one is to participate physically, socially, and psychologically. This requires participants' high functioning of cognitive components or executive ability and motor recovery. Hence, community integration is positively associated with functional independence and measure and IADL. Similarly, the functional independence is also significantly associated with IADL. Next, male stroke survivor has all the significant improvement in functional ability and IADL and community integration than female stroke participants. This is because in female, stroke occurs in later life than male and causes greater risk and functional impairment. Stronger stroke impact in female causes more dependent in their basic day-to-day activities. Female stroke survivor less likely to engage in post-stroke social and leisure activities and gives more values to their body image. Hence, restrict their participation in home and community. Coming to the limitation and recommendation, sampling bias, definitely, this is because the study is the participant are recruited consecutively. This was a hospital-based study. This can be recommended further studies addressing the problem of external validity. Other factors like cognition, executive function, speech is not taken into consideration for successful return of community integration. This can be recommended for further study, limited to eastern zone of India. And replication of similar study in different communities in other regions of the country with different cultural background is suggested. Coming to conclusion, male stroke has better improvement in functional performance and community than females. Post-stroke individual functional independence at participant in IADL has association with their community integration. Rehabilitation of post-stroke should not neglect the community integration of the individual. Occupational therapy should focus on functional activities which help the stroke survivor to perform activities within the complex social context of everyday life. Hence, rehabilitation will be successful, helping post-stroke individual return to home, participation in society, and to integrate back into the community to maintain the life fullest. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Naprabha Mahuswat.
Thank you, sir.
Participants, is there any questions related to this paper?
Sir, there are no questions as of till now.
Okay.
So, sir, if you have any, you can directly. So, we are taking two questions for each paper. Your time constraint. So, if you have any, you can go ahead with.
Sir, Amitabh, sir.
So, I don't have any question for this presenter, and I just say thanks for her nice presentations. It was a good presentation. I think now we can call upon the second presenter, Dr. Baldeep Kaur. Right? Title of presentation is Occupational Therapy Intervention in a Young Onset Parkinson's Disease, a Case Study. This is a competitive category. So I want to speak few words before the presentation. And I want to thank you, Dr. Somyakant Sahu, for a warm welcome and a very good afternoon, everyone. It is a great experience for all of us for having Oticon 2021 on this virtual platform. This will be an important milestone in the history of occupational therapy. Continuing the spread and share of knowledge, I would like to open the scientific session 5, which is already opened, and I'm sorry for that. And now we are going for the second paper, and I invite Dr. Baldeep Kaur to start his presentation. Thank you, Soumyakant, and thanks for everything.
No problem. My pleasure, sir.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon to all the panelists, the participants, and the other viewers. So the topic for today is occupational therapy intervention in young onset Parkinson's disease, a case report. Introduction. Young onset Parkinson's disease is a rare neurodegenerative slow progressive condition seen in people less than 50 years of age. It affects dopamine producing cells in the substantia nigra of midbrain. The clinical features are tremors, rigidity, bradykinesia, and postural instability. Along with that, some other features are dyskinesia, dystonia, due to which the patients complain of frequent falls due to freezing and also reduced community mobility. They also complain of ADL limitations. Some other non-motor features are pain, anxiety, and depression. The rationale for selecting the patient, Mrs. M was selected as young onset Parkinson's disease is a rare diagnosis. She is a female aged 32 years of age. She is in the prime of her life and also has altered life roles due to Parkinson's disease. The lifelong impact of the Parkinson's disease on movements and activities has affected her quality of life, but not the lifespan. Also, this case study is solely for educational purpose as there are really very few evidence-based therapeutic research on BioPD. Case description. The patient informed that she first consulted a multi-specialty hospital when she observed slowness of movements and tremulousness in January 2019. There, she was diagnosed as a case of hypothyroidism. Eventually, the tremulousness increased and she also developed postural instability in January 2020 with a few complaints of falls. So she was referred to a tertiary care center where she was diagnosed as young onset Parkinson's disease on the basis of clinical evaluation. Recently, her symptoms increased more in August 2020 and she was referred to occupational therapy department in the same tertiary care center for intervention. On interviewing, she herself said that she loses balance, her hands and legs shake, she feels fatigued easily. Her main concern was that she's not able to feed her daughter. On clinical evaluation, she was found to have tremors, fog wheel rigidity, postural instability, gait affectations, bradykinesia, slow, low volume speech, micrographia, masked face, weakness, and ADL affectations. Methodology. The patient was referred to occupational therapy department in August 2020. She was selected for the case report as the diagnosis is very rare and also she had many clinical symptoms limiting her ADL functions. She was treated with occupational therapy intervention for 3 months, during which time she was evaluated using Movement Disorder Society sponsored revised Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Score pre and post intervention. She was treated using person environment occupation model, which was and also rehabilitative frame of reference, keeping in mind her personal self-esteem, her cultural background, her environment and occupation in mind. In person, her basic ADLs were affected. She was found to have no leisure activity. She was also found to be dependent on others for her ADLs. Her time management and skills were poor, and she also has difficulty in fulfilling her life roles. As a wife, as a mother, she has limited space at her house, which leads to repeated falling. Also, due to her disease, she complains of marital disharmony and poor family support. She has left her job as a housekeeping and has also left her pastime as a handicraft artist. We use rehabilitative frame of reference, wherein she was taught adaptive strategies, compensatory techniques, cueing and planning, so that she fulfills her life roles. Here we can see in the first picture that we focus more on her flexibility and strengthening exercises. In the second picture, we focused more on the balance activities, that is lateral step ups, front and backward step ups. In the third picture, we can see that we told her to do a new activity, that is walking in a figure of eight pattern, so that it reduces her chances of fall. In the fourth activity, we are working on her fine motor skills. The outcome measure used was Movement Disorder Society sponsored revision of Unified Parkinson Disease Rating Scale. It is the most used scale to assess the clinical severity of Parkinson disease. It consists of four sections. Part one consists of non-motor experiences of daily living. Part two consists of motor experiences of daily living. Part three is motor examination. Part four is motor complication. The lower the scores, the better are the clinical conditions. Now, these are the results. These are the some components of the UPDRS, which state that she has lowered scores post-intervention. In facial expression, it has reduced from 2 to 1. This is the next table, which highlights that her scores has reduced. Now, this is a graph depicting all the four parts of MDS-UPDRS. Now, here we can see that in non-motor, components of daily living, experiences of daily living, the scores reduced from 12 to 7. Now, in motor components of experiences of daily living, the scores reduced from 18 to 11. On motor examination, the scores were found to be drastically reduced from 42 to 33. And in motor complications, the scores were reduced from 8 to 5. Discussion. We used a PEO-based model because it's an individualized approach. Even the further previous researches done by Wellesby et al. In the year 2019, concludes that a tailor-made, goal-oriented approach benefits the people with Parkinson's disease. We have also used rehabilitative frame of reference so that it involves correction of faulty biomechanical techniques and improvement of motor and non-motor performance. Conclusion: significant improvement in scores in UPDRS was seen, which concludes that a tailor-made approach is the best suited for patients with young onset Parkinson's disease. Patient's perspective. The patient in her own words say that she now feels more confident in her activities of daily living, and also she feels competent in fulfilling her life role as a mother. She also says that she feels reduction in her stiffness. The limitations of the study are that since it is a single case report, so the results cannot be generalized. Also, different patients may have different clinical presentations, so they'll have to be worked upon differently. We'd like to thank HOD of our Occupational Therapy Department for allowing us to conduct the study, and also the patient references. These are the references. Thank you.
It was a nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Now if there is any question, I think Dr. Soumyakant can ask.
So there are no questions as such from audience in the Q&A. Okay. So if you or Dr. Jagdishan has any, so he can ask, or you, if you have any, you can ask.
Yeah, I like to ask one question to presenter. She has been used PEO-based treatment protocol, that is individualized approach. So
yes.
What was the reason to select this PEO-based approach? Please give little brief about that. What are the components?
Sorry to interrupt. There are questions. I think they are not being linked in this Zoom meeting. Sir, if you have a question, please go ahead with it. Otherwise, I will ask from the audience.
Yeah, if there are questions, you go ahead, Dr. Srihas.
So the question is, what is the reliability of the outcome measure?
Okay. MDS-UPDRS has a very good reliability and it is already being used by many of the neurologists to assess the outcome.
Okay. Any other questions the chair wants to ask? Okay, thank you. We'll proceed. Samyakanta, can you please proceed with the next?
Yeah. Now, the third presenter for the session is Dr. Kamal Narayan Arya, sir. And his topic is sensory motor therapies to augment upper limb recovery in a stroke, a systematic review. Now I call upon Dr. Kamal Narayan Arya, sir, for his presentation. This is under non-competitive category.
Go ahead. Okay, good afternoon to all again. The topic of my present this review is sensory-based motor therapies enhancing upper limb recovery among post-stroke subject, a systematic review. The study has been registered under PROSPERO and it has been financially supported by Indian Council of Medical Research, New Delhi. And we have followed PRISMA guidelines while reporting this study and there's no conflict of interest in presentation. Most of the stroke rehabilitation regimes focus primarily on the motor aspect. Somatosensory deficit after stroke are not unusual. Stroke individuals may experience difficulty in perceiving touch, pressure, proprioception, and stereognosis. Upper limb sensory impairment affect motor recovery. However, identification and management of these subtle inabilities has not been effectively considered in OT practice. Sensory interventions ranging from passive to active techniques have been investigated. Passive techniques usually comprise the method which doesn't have the active participation of the subject, such as electrical stimulation. While active method comprises of the specific training of the impaired sensory modality that usually provides a context of integrated goal-directed tasks, and they're based on neuroplasticity principles, and they also have a potential to augment substantial motor recovery. There are a few existing reviews which has been conducted in the last decade, and all of them have some or the other knowledge gap. For instance, Sarada et al. Has the knowledge gap for combining the active, passive, and hybrid technique of the intervention, and that is both for the upper and lower limbs. Ilmezar and Turville has not used any motor outcome measure. Moreover, they have excluded, that especially the Turville have excluded the studies of sensory therapy enhancing motor recovery. Similarly, Grant M. et al. Have also combined the active and stimulation and thermal techniques together. So the rationale of our review was, there's a need to ascertain the effectiveness of active sensory-based motor therapies exclusively in stroke. And the objective of the study was to systematically review studies on active sensory motor therapies for upper limb recovery in stroke. So methods, our data sources were PubMed, DORIS, PEDRO, OT Seeker, and Cochrane Central Register of Trials. We have considered studies which were published in English till 30th April 2020. And our primary keywords were stroke, CVA, hemiparesis, and combined with the sensory aspects, we have developed different search strategies for different databases. Our main eligibility criteria were population, ischemic and hemorrhagic stroke, hemiparesis, upper limb sensory deficit, while we excluded the studies which were conducted on pure sensory stroke, traumatic head injury, and in neuropathy or complex regional pain syndrome. Intervention, we have exclusively considered active sensory motor training for upper limb, while we excluded the studies on electrical stimulation, non-invasive brain stimulation, thermal, compression, acupuncture, or robotics. We have included the study designs of randomized controlled trial or even quasi-experimental. However, we have excluded the studies of the cohort, single case, case series, or retrospective studies. Our primary outcome measure was the motor recovery of the upper limb, and the secondary outcome measure was the sensory recovery of the upper limb. The data was extracted by the different authors, and the procedure we have followed is the initial screening by the two authors, then full text screening by the three authors. In case of any disagreement, we have consulted the four author. We have also developed a data extraction form, which mainly comprises setting, demographic and baseline characteristic, experimental and control interventions, randomizations and allocation process, blinding, outcome measures, and mechanism of intervention. The quality assessment of the studies were conducted by using a Pedro scale, and is a 10-point scale and commonly used for the quality assessment, the systematic reviews of the included studies. Anything more than 7 is considered as a high quality, something 5 or 6 considered as a moderate quality, and something less than 4 is considered as a poor quality. The findings of the study were reported in the form of a narrative review. Due to limited homogeneous studies, meta-analysis was not conducted. Results. The records which were identified in the database were around 3,229 studies. And then we applied the filters and removed the duplicates. And finally, we got 916 studies whose title and abstract were screened. And out of that, 902 studies were again excluded because they were not matching to our inclusion criteria. And then we have assessed the full text of the 14 studies. And out of that 14, 7 were excluded for different reasons, such as outcome measures, or design, or the intervention. And finally, we have conducted the qualitative synthesis of 7 studies. These are those 7 studies. Out of the 7 studies, majority were conducted in the Asian continent, and 2 were in the European continent. The design ranged from quasi to the randomized trial. The sample size ranged from 8 to 56, while the quality of the Pedro on the Pedro scale ranged from 3 to 8. These are 5 types of therapy which has come out of this systematic review. The first is the mirror therapy, mental imaging, sensory motor functional activity, cognitive sensory motor therapy, and sensory constraint therapy. Coming to mirror therapy, only one study used this concept of mirror therapy, in which the sensory motor tasks performed by the less affected upper limb were applied to induce the illusion of the affected limb. Sensory perception on the less affected hand was provided using various texture, shapes, and sizes of the object. Mental imaging. 2 studies use this concept, in which the kinesthetic imagery of one's own movement were provided, especially for the challenging movements such as shoulder abduction and elbow extension. Mental imagery of sensory motor and edial activities were also provided. Sensory motor functional tasks. 3 studies use this concept, in which the activities such as weight and texture discrimination, with or without vision, was provided. Reaching, grasping, manipulation using different types of objects, shapes, and sizes were also imparted. The 4th type, that is cognitive sensory motor therapy, only one study this used this concept of cognitive aspect, in which they have only provided the proprioceptive training and the practice of the upper limb joint position with and without vision. Along with that, they've also added the perception of shape, size, and position of the object. The last type, that is sensory constraint therapy, only one study used this concept of sensory constraint therapy, in which there's a constraint of the less affected upper limb behind the back of the body to restrain the sensory and motor inputs. Sensory and functional activities were imparted by the affected upper limb, similar to the motor activities. These were the outcome measures which were used in these studies. There are 3 categories of outcome measures which we could find. One is the category of the motor control assessment, that is Bernstrom recovery stage and FMA upper extremity assessment. Second category is the motor functional assessment used in the stroke, such as action research arm test, Wolf motor function test, motor activity log, and motricity index. The 3rd category on the right side was all the generic assessment used for the hand function, such as 9-hole pack test, box and block, Purdue, and hand grip dynamometer. For sensory measures, Siemens-Winston monofilament, 2-point discrimination test, Nottingham sensory assessment, and kinesthetic visual imagery questionnaire were the commonly used measures. Effectiveness. Most of these studies have not found any effectiveness on the sensory aspect, except 3 intervention has found some of the changes. For instance, sensory discrimination found the changes for the pressure. Mirror therapy found the changes for the touch and wrist and hand control, while the kinesthetic motor imagery find the changes for the upper extremity control. Rest of the intervention have not found any substantial or significant change after the intervention. The doses of this intervention raised from 100 minute to 1400 minute approximately. discussion, varied aspects of active sensory motor therapies were found in selected studies. Qualitative synthesis of selected articles indicate the importance of therapy. However, the robust evidence for the effectiveness couldn't be deduced. Two studies, high quality, found favorable role of active sensory therapy in enhancing motor recovery. The rest of the studies, which were less than the moderate quality, observed non-superior results. Components of mirror therapy and mental imagery may be considered vital to induce activation. Sensory motor training provides feed forward and feedback practice. Cognitive abilities are involved in perceiving sensation and executing movements. Somatosensations and movements are integral component of motor control. Usual rehabilitation protocols comprise some element of sensory demand. Structure training of sensory deficit is missing in the available motor therapies. In view of neuroplasticity principles, duration plays a crucial role in inducing favorable changes. Low dose, something less than 4,000 minute intervention, could explain the unfavorable response in some of these studies. Limitations. Only limited number of databases we have explored, and the English language is one of the inclusion criteria limitation, and there's a lack of homogeneous and good quality trials were found in this review. Conclusion. Active sensory motor therapy is a vital aspect of stroke rehabilitation. Good quality trials are warranted to investigate the effectiveness of active sensory therapy. Stroke-specific motor and sensory measures are recommended to be used. Specific sensory and motor impairments, as well as doses, need to be considered in protocol. A structured active sensory motor protocol should have components of sensation, motor, cognition, and function. I would like to acknowledge my director and head of department. These are some of my references which have been used in this review. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kamal Narayan Araya, sir. We will take questions now.
Sure.
There are no questions in the auditorium.
Okay, there is no question.
I'm here to answer any question in the chat box. I'm here till the session is going on.
Okay, fine. So, may I proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now I would like to call upon Dr. Damayanti Sethi, and her topic is backward and side walking improves walking speed and endurance in patient with stroke hemiplegia. This paper is under non-competitive category. Dr. Damayanti Sethi, I would request you to start your presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Respected chairperson and co-chairperson, the title of my presentation today is Backward and Side Walking Training Improves Walking Speed and Endurance in Subjects with Post-Stroke Hemiparesis. Coming to the background, walking is an important human activity which enables us to be productive and participative members of a community. Walking after stroke is characterized by slow gait speed, endurance, and change in the quality and adaptability of walking patterns. Side stability, symmetrical weight bearing, and backward motor control ability is required to improve walking function. Speed and endurance are two important factors that influence how long the patient will be able to retain the ability to walk. Few studies have been conducted on the combined effect of backward walking training and side walking training. So this study is conducted to investigate the combined effect of backward walking training and side walking training on walking speed and endurance in chronic stroke hemiplegics. Coming to the methodology, a convenient sample of 56 stroke hemiplegic subjects attending Department of OT NILD Kolkata were recruited for the study. The inclusion criteria were patients who had stroke for 6 months and more, ages from ranging from 35 to 65 years, and individuals who could walk independently for at least 10 meters. Patients having severe cognitive and other orthopedic problems were excluded from the study. All subjects provided written informed consent. The participants who fulfilled the inclusion criteria were randomly assigned to experimental and control group. All the measurements were recorded by your rater, who is blinded to the group allocation. The subjects in the experimental group received 30 minutes of backward walking and side walking training, along with 30 minutes of conventional walking, conventional occupational therapy. The subjects in the control group received conventional occupational therapy for 60 minutes. The duration of therapy was 5 days a week for 6 weeks for a total of 30 sessions. Post-treatment measurements for all the outcome measures were taken after 6 weeks of intervention. These are the two outcome measures which are used. The 10-meter walk test was used to evaluate walking speed, and 6-minute walk test was used to evaluate the endurance. Now coming to the intervention, participants of the experimental group had finished 30 sessions of backward and side walking training program. Initially, during the first 2 to 4 sessions, the subjects were asked to take few steps backward with the therapist's assistance. Then they are asked to walk actively without assistance. They are instructed to walk in their comfortable speed without following a specific pattern of walking. Gradually, the distance of walking was increased progressively. During the first few sessions, they were asked to walk within the department in a 10-meter long straight track, and gradually the distance was increased to a maximum of 60 meters. For side walking training, the same procedure was used, except here the patient had to walk sideways. The gait speed and pace were not imposed on the patient. There was no constraint indication about head and trunk position during the backward and side walking training. Standby assistance was provided to all the subjects for safety purpose. Subjects in the control group received conventional therapy, including preambulation activities, strengthening of lower limb, and forward walking training. Data and statistical analysis. Data was analyzed by SPSS. Peer t-test was used to compare the differences within each group, and independent t-test was used to compare the difference between both the groups. Coming to the results, according to the results of this study, there were significant changes in walking speed and walking endurance within each group. There were significant differences found in gait speed and endurance between both the groups. The 6-minute walk test score showed significant improvement in experimental group and showed nominal improvement in control group, which is not significant. The 10-meter walk test showed significant improvements in experimental group and in control group too. The within group analysis shows that there is a significant improvement in the walking speed and endurance in experimental group. Though subjects in control group had improvement in walking speed, improvement in walking endurance was very minimal. The result of the study is shown in this table. This is the within group analysis of results. The result of between group analysis showed that there is a significant difference found between the experimental and control group in 10-meter walk test and 6-minute walk test. The result of this study showed better improvement in walking speed as well as walking endurance in experimental group than the conventional therapy group. The between group analysis is shown in this table. Now coming to the discussion, the result of this study shows that combination of backward and side walking training improved walking speed in chronic stroke hemiplegics. Walking speed was increased both in experimental and control group. Experimental group showed a better improvement over control group in walking speed. The improvement in gait speed may be attributed to the decrease in the predominance of extensor synergy through practice of backward walking, improved balance, and improved symmetry of gait. The reorganization of muscle synergies or neuromotor control of lower limbs during backward walking might be a possible reason for the improvement of balance and thereby improving the walking speed. Of the common impairments, muscle strength, motor control, and balance appears to be the strongest relation with walking. The hip abductor muscles play an important biomechanical role in humans and are an essential pivotal point in mobilization of the body weight. Backward and side walking training might have improved strength of gluteus maximus, hamstrings, and gluteus medius muscles respectively. These muscles are the primary hip stabilizers, and the improved strength might have contributed for improved stability at the hip and resulting in improved walking speed in the experimental group. Walking endurance remains the most striking area of difficulty among the stroke individuals with stroke. Individuals after stroke generally have low endurance for exercise because of the immobility. The result of this study indicated that walking endurance of chronic stroke hemiplegics in experimental group had significantly improved after 6 weeks, of backward and side walking training in comparison to the minimal improvement in control group that received conventional therapy alone. It is well established that repetitions play a major role in structural reorganization of the brain, and task-oriented activities are a key to functional recovery. So ADL-related activities such as walking may be used to influence aerobic performance. In this study, repetitive backward and side walking training in the experimental group might have improved the aerobic performance than conventional therapy. It has also been found that backward walking improves the peak oxygen uptake level in stroke patients. The repetitive backward and side walking training in experimental group might have improved the peak oxygen uptake level, thereby improving the walking endurance. These are the limitations of my study. Only chronic stroke hemiplegics were included in the study, and there was no follow-up conducted. So the transfer of institution-based training to community ambulation could not be evaluated. Future studies can be conducted in subacute stroke population with the follow-up evaluation. Now coming to the conclusion, this study indicates that backward and side walking training can improve the walking speed and walking endurance of stroke hemiplegics. Backward and side walking training can be combined together to provide to improve the walking ability better than the conventional therapy. These are very simple form of daily activities that can be included in the hemiplegic subject's daily routine of activities. These are some of my references. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Damayanti Sethi. Let's take question for her.
Sriha sir, are there any questions in the auditorium?
Not yet.
Amitabh sir or
Jagdishan
sir, if any question you have, you can ask. Otherwise, we can move to the next speaker.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
I think it's a very interesting talk. I've really enjoyed it. I have just two questions. First of all, what was the rationale that you have only used the chronic strokes? It could have very well done. And the second question is that you not used the hip flexors. What was the reason? Because the iliopsoas, which is again one of the muscle. I know you have used mainly the hip abductors and the hip extensors, the gluteus maximus, and the hip abductors, the gluteus medius and minimus. But because since you chose backward and the sidewalks, without hip flexors, how are you able to walk? The other muscles, extensors, hip, like gluteus maximus, they cannot work because there is a reciprocal action. So what is the rationale?
Sir, actually, very specifically, I focused on walking speed and endurance here. So my the basic factors, what I thought is to include is the stabilization of the hip. If the stabilization of the hip is good or it can be improved, then there can be a better improvement in walking. In forward walking and all in conventional, I have included conventional occupational therapy along with these two walking patterns, sir, where the persons also will be in the conventional therapy, they were walking forward also, where the iliopsoas they are in use already. Because I have used backward walking and sideways walking, the rationale behind using these two walkings only is to improve the stabilization, the gait in side walking, the symmetry and the dynamic weight shifts. If these things can be improved better, then there can be a better walking ability. I included only these two specific walking backward and the side walking. They were already taking conventional therapy along with these two walking, sir.
Okay. Yeah, that's okay. And that, anyway, we have no time. You can also look at it, the lateral rotators, another very important.
Yes, sir.
Lateral rotators, which also stabilizes. Anyway, look into that. Thank you.
Okay, definitely. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So, organizers, is there any question, further question?
Not yet, sir.
Okay. So, may we proceed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, now let me call upon the next presenter, Dr. Santa Pandya, and her topic is Underlying Mechanism of Synergy in a Stroke, Implication for Rehabilitation, a Review. So, Dr. Santa Pandya, please start with...
Good afternoon, everybody. The topic of my presentation is Underlying Mechanism of Synergy in Stroke, Implication for Rehabilitation. It is a review. The term synergy often used in neuroscience field. It basically signifies working together or functioning in a coordinated manner. Activation of group of muscles which contribute to a purposeful movement is basically known as synergy, and its linkage is constrained by central nervous system. The synchronization gets hampered and it appears as an abnormal synergy among post-stroke subjects. Individual synergistic component had been studied and found to be evident, but the process of appearing and disappearing has not been investigated extensively. Distorted post-stroke synergy was first elaborated by Sidney Brunstorm in 1966. Motor recovery appears in a stage-wise pattern, and stroke rehabilitation is scarcely possible without incorporating the concept of synergy. Muscle synergies can be used as a reference for motor recovery after cortical insult. Structured synergy-based protocols in stroke is not evident. The objective of this review was to review the underlying mechanism of synergy among post-stroke subjects and to review clinical implications in view of the available protocols and the mechanism of synergy. The methodology used was articles published in last 20 years in English language, and the database used was Google Scholar, Medline, PubMed, and Cochrane, and published in any index journal. All type of studies were included: systematic, non-systematic reviews, randomized control trial, non-randomized control trial, single group designs, correlation, and analytical designs. The keywords for to search the evidences were stroke and synergy, upper limb, stereotyped motor behavior, motor control, reach, grasp. The type of participant in the study were post-stroke hemiparesis in acute, subacute, or chronic stages, and the type of stroke was ischemic or hemorrhagic stroke, but non-traumatic. The outcome measures used in the studies were Fugelmayer assessment and Brunstorm recovery stage, any other stroke-specific motor assessments, neuroelectrophysiological measures, and robotic-based assessments. 36 studies were included for this review that mainly comprised of analytical studies and correlational designs, lab studies with sophisticated devices, systematic and non-systematic reviews, and there were very few randomized controlled trials and experimental studies. Coming to the result, as per the findings of these review and the articles, the result was divided into these four sections: neurophysiology of synergy, biomechanics and kinesiology of synergy, its implications, and the available treatment protocols. Synergy is coordinated and constrained by the central nervous system as per the functional need demands. It basically comprises co- and reciprocal activation of varied group of muscles. Pathological synergies were found to be altered from its basic characteristics. It appears with the missing motor components, and it takes a shape of stereotypical motor presentation after stroke. Varied abnormal reflexes are being evident at different motor stages. Subject progress from no reflex to brisk reflex activity during the recovery process, and it exhibits a normal reflex after achieving a good voluntary motor control movement. An altered reflex coordination indicate or contribute for impaired arm functions. Shoulder and elbow muscle demonstrated comparative alternations between affected and less affected side. Shoulder abductors and elbow flexors are found to be the very strong components, and it abnormally get coupled during any voluntary arm movement. In an electroencephalography study, it shows abnormal cortical control of shoulder abduction and elbow flexion. Individual shoulder and elbow control is very important for the function of arms, such as reaching. Its achievement signifies the very good voluntary motor control of arm. Wrist and fingers were found to be involuntary coupled with the certain shoulder and elbow movements. Sensors has been used in the evidences to analyze the upper extremity kinematics and was being compared with the Fugelmayer and Fugelmayer assessment scale. Pathological coupling was found to be evident through the relation between the arm. Strong synergistic linkage and weakness in the shoulder, elbow, and wrist was found to be evident. In a study of electromyography finding, it suggested magnitude of flexor synergy was more at the distal than proximal, and shoulder abduction get coupled with elbow flexion, and it hinders all arm functions. Elbow extensors were recorded to be significant predictor for forward reach. A higher number of muscle synergies reflect greater movement complexity, and muscle synergies can be identified and monitored during therapy. Increased number of synergies indicate improved motor control. The implications, underlying neural mechanism, hampered synergy strongly indicate for clinical implications. Flexor synergy shall be targeted during the intervention, and combination of synergies can be exploited to achieve gross and fine motor skills. In a brain-machine interface study, a decreased accuracy was recorded during hand opening while activating the shoulder abductors. Synergy-based rehabilitation models can be designed to discourage the compensatory strategies and to enhance independent coordination patterns. Combination of shoulder movements are always a challenge to achieve. Most common misclassification was being recorded in the literature, that is shoulder abduction and external rotation, and shoulder adduction and internal rotation. These two set of movements of shoulder can be achieved at the last or the good motor recovery stage subjects. Arm shall be targeted prior to hand for motor intervention. Motor therapy targeting synergies should be based on site of lesion, severity of impairment, and stage of motor recovery stage of stroke. Simple to complex motor tasks should be provided to overcome the abnormal synergy. Fugelmayer assessment and brainstorm recovery stage are the most widely used clinical measures in the synergy studies. Task-based training program was applied to break unwanted flexor synergies of fingers among chronic stroke subjects. Synergy-based task training led to reduction in abnormal synergy and improvement in precision, pinch, and clinical hand functions. In a brain-machine interface study, it was utilized for desynchronization of arm and forearm muscles, and it was found to be effective mode of rehabilitation for chronic stroke subjects. In intense robot-mediated planar movements were provided for shoulder, and intervention enhanced the coordinated activity of impaired muscles of arm. Hence, from this review, it can be concluded that normal synergy is a basic fundamental in the field of neuroscience, and abnormal synergy is the challenge in neurorehabilitation field. There exists a neural mechanism for post-stroke synergy. Evidence are focused mainly on evaluation of synergy. Protocols utilizing the concept is very sparse. Development of synergy-based protocols is warranted, and protocols should be based on evidence of underlying synergy mechanism. These are my references I reviewed in this article. My sincere thanks to my head of the department and director of the institute. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Santhya Pandya. It was an interesting topic and nice presentation. Let's take question for her. Dr. Sihas, Dr. Soumya Kant, is there any question?
I don't think so, sir. Probably if both of you
have, and Dr. Jagdishan, if you have any question, he can ask, or you can ask also. There is no question.
Yes, question, I don't have any questions, sir. Thank you, Dr. Santha Pandian. It's a new thing. Most of students will use this advanced technologies. What you have shown in your presentation. Thank you, Dr. Santha Pandian.
Thank you.
Hello, Chair. Can I just say that? Can I come in?
Yes, sir.
You know, I don't have any questions, but I want to really congratulate. It's a very good, very
there
good.
There are no questions still.
Very nice study. I think
we can move to the
thank
next.
You, sir. Thank you. Yeah,
because there's some latest research has come up.
Am I audible?
Yeah, I mean, she used very good references because the Bunstrom approach, it was 1960.
Am I audible?
So since then, a lot
yes,
of
yes, yes, you are audible.
Good study.
There are no questions here, sir.
Okay. Please proceed. Srihas, you may ask questions.
Question.
There is no question. We can go to the next speaker, though.
I'll call Dr. Aradhana Naik for the next presentation. So he's going to present in the topic of behavioral intervention for bladder control, its impact on quality of life in person with traumatic paraplegia.
Thank you. So the topic of my presentation is behavioral intervention for bladder control, its impact on quality of life in persons with traumatic paraplegia. So first, coming to the introduction, we all are very familiar with the series of debilitating complications after spinal cord injury. And among other complications after spinal cord injury, disturbances of bladder function poses a life-threatening impact. Urogenital condition stands at fourth position with a prevalence of 11.5% among different causes of death in spinal cord injury. The problems arising from the lack of bladder control directly impact quality of life after spinal cord injury due to social withdrawal, lowered self-esteem, increased marital problems, and sexual dysfunction. So to address these problems, in the study, we have used behavioral intervention with triad of intervention techniques. First is the urinary incontinence education, which includes the bladder education and education about the complications. Then is the bladder training, which constitutes of maintaining bladder diary, scheduling voiding interval according to the diary, and using relaxation techniques to control the urge of voiding when it is necessary. And lastly, it is the pelvic floor muscle exercises, which includes first locating the pelvic floor muscles properly, then giving equal duration for contraction of the muscles and relaxation of the muscles, and lastly, increasing the duration and repetitions with the time. Coming to the rationale of our study, though behavioral intervention has a broad research base to be beneficial in case of urinary incontinence, but there was a lack of evidence to practice it clinically for developing bladder control in patients with traumatic paraplegia in Indian population. So the objective of our study was to determine the effect of behavioral intervention on bladder control and quality of life in patients with traumatic paraplegia, and to find the relationship between status of bladder control and quality of life. Next, coming to the methodology, SCI impairment scale was used as a screening tool, and the outcome measures were urogenital distress inventory UDI-6, incontinence quality of life IQOL. Study design was pre-test, post-test, single group experimental study design. Sampling and setting, 36 traumatic paraplegics were recruited with convenient sampling. The period of study was from January 2013 to April 2014, and the study was conducted at a tertiary care rehabilitation institute. Both male and female medically stable cases of traumatic paraplegia within an age group of 18 to 55 years who were rated as motor incomplete with voluntary anal contraction were recruited into the study, and the patients having major pathological conditions of bladder like UTI, renal problems like renal stones or renal calculi, orthopedic conditions like pelvic fracture, and surgically managed cases for bladder dysfunction were excluded from the study. Now coming to the procedure. First, the informed consent from each participant were taken after describing them about the purpose of the study. Then the bladder, then their bladder history and daily fluid intake were recorded. Then behavioral intervention along with traditional bladder management was provided for 8 weeks. Pre and post intervention data was recorded using UDI-6 and IQOL. Follow-up data were recorded 6 months after completion of intervention to measure the retention effect. The study was conducted in adherence to the principles of the Declaration of Helsinki. Coming to the intervention protocol, first, the participants were asked to keep a bladder diary for at least 3 days and was given a urinary incontinence education about the problems that they are going to face and how to manage them and how to maintain the hygiene. Then the training intervention program was for 8 weeks, which included 4 weeks of intensive training and 4 weeks of self-training. And this was the format of the bladder diary that was provided to the participants. And in the intervention protocol, in the first week, 1 hour of daily session was taken in which pelvic floor muscle exercises were demonstrated to the participants when they were asked to practice during the session, and they are asked to maintain their daily bladder diary. And during the second, third, and fourth week, weekly once, 1 hour of session was taken, and there also pelvic floor muscle exercise was demonstrated, and the participants were asked to practice during the session. And the voiding interval for each participant was readjusted according to their bladder diary. And in the fourth week, feedback and reinforcement was provided to the participants for further self-training, and they were asked to reschedule their voiding program and maintain the bladder diary till the end of the 8th week of intervention. Coming to the data analysis. Analysis was done by using SPSS version 20.0. Level of significance set at alpha less than 0.05. Friedman test along with post hoc Wilcoxon signed rank test were used to analyze the pre-intervention, post-intervention and follow-up data of both UDI-6 and IQOL. And to know the correlation between the scores of UDI-6 and IQOL, Kendall's tau correlation coefficient was used for the pre-intervention data from both the slides. Now coming to the results, the first table is showing the demographic characteristics of the participants, where we could recruit 31 males and 5 female participants, and the male is to female ratio was 6.2:1. This is the descriptive statistics of the scores on the outcome measures. Now coming to the statistical analysis, table 3 is showing the result of Friedman test and post hoc Wilcoxon signed rank test. Analysis of pre with the post intervention data and pre intervention with follow up data for both the scales in both the tests showed significant improvement, but the analysis of post intervention data with follow up data didn't show any significant change, which implies there was a retention effect. Coming to the table 4, the result of Kendall's tau correlation coefficient for UDI-6 and IQOL pre-intervention scores are seen, was shown in this table, and we found a very high negative correlation between the data. Now coming to the discussion. Behavioral intervention was found to be effective in improving bladder control in patients with traumatic paraplegia. And these changes could have happened because of modification in voiding behavior through appropriate education about bladder and its related complications, individually adjusted programs for habit formation, and strengthening of muscles that controls the bladder and sphincter. There was found a low incidence of urinary tract damage and decrease in adverse consequence of bladder dysfunction followed by the intervention. Our findings are supported by a systematic review done by Peter T. Dorsher and Peter M. McIntosh in the year 2012 on neurogenic bladder problems, and a study done by F. Jamil in the year 2001 on catheter-free status in neurogenic bladder dysfunctions. Further, the study found a strong negative correlation between status of bladder control and quality of life, which implied poor status of bladder control is related to poorer quality of life. Previous studies had also supported the idea that bladder problems remain the most important issue in quality of life of patients with chronic spinal cord injury apart from physical problems. Bowel and bladder problems negatively influence quality of life due to fear of embarrassment about incontinence. Lastly, coming to the conclusion, behavioral intervention showed to have significant effect in improving bladder control and positively influence quality of life. Our study provided an evidence-based platform along with all the statistical proof for occupational therapists to confidently select it for managing bladder-related problems during the rehabilitation program. Problems related to bladder incontinence plays a remarkable role in diminishing quality of life, so incontinence issues must be given equal importance while rehabilitating patients with traumatic paraplegia. These are my references. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Aradhana. It was a very nice presentation, and the topic selected by you is very, very good. And I think we need lots of study on this bladder and bowel control, because I think it's a little neglected area from us. So thank you again. And we will take up questions now for Aradhana. Dr. Srihas and Dr. Soumya Kant, please.
Dr. Srihas, I don't think there are any question.
Why a wide range of patients were selected for your study, because effects of the treatments are with lots of variation as far as to draw inferences.
Sorry, sir, can you repeat again?
Why was such a wide range of patients selected for your study? Because effects of treatments are with lot of variations as far to draw inferences.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the question. So the articles and that I have chosen, they have actually used like this age range for their intervention. So that's why I chose to go with that age range.
Okay. That's the only question that is there.
Okay. Okay. So now we can proceed for the next presentation.
Yes, sir.
Yes. For the next presentation, I would like to call upon Dr. Akshay Kumar Joshi. And his topic for presentation is a novel sensory rehabilitation protocol in post-stroke hemiplegics, a feasibility study. This paper is under competitive category.
Good evening, all. My today's topic is novel sensory rehabilitation protocol in post-stroke hemiplegics, a feasibility study. Stroke subjects exhibit varied impairments lead to hampered independent functioning. Motor impairment is the most common clinically observed deficits. However, more than 85% of stroke survivors experience sensory impairment. In spite, motor rehab has always been emphasized upon. Post-stroke survivors faces sensory impairments include deficit in tactile, proprioception, cognosis, two-point discrimination, and vibration sense. Sensory and motor impairments are evident to be interlinked. Low level of sensory recovery leads to hampered motor recovery. For instance, poor light touch in the hand causes impaired dexterity. Various techniques have been studied for sensory motor recovery, but there is lack of neural-based principle as well as structured intervention. Thus, the evidence of for effectiveness is weak for the available technique. So there is need to develop a novel sensory rehabilitation protocol. Objective of the current study was to assess feasibility of a novel sensory rehab protocol based on the principle of neuroplasticity method. It is a pre-post single group feasibility design. Place of the study is Neuro Rehab Unit OT Department, PDU, NIPPD, New Delhi, India. Ethical approval was taken from Institutional Ethical Committee, PDU, NIPPD. Being a feasibility study, only 10 subjects were enrolled for an ongoing trial. Inclusion criteria are as follows: age 20 to 80 years, both gender, ischemic and or hemorrhagic stroke, post-stroke duration 1 to 12 months, sensory and motor deficit in upper extremity. Exclusion criteria are communication and language disorder, contracture and deformity for hand and finger, complex regional pain syndrome, severe cognitive or perceptual deficits, diabetic or any other neuropathy. So, intervention, a novel protocol neuroplasticity principle-based sensory rehabilitation, NEPSR, has been developed. The protocol has already been published in an indexed and peer-reviewed journal. Neuroplasticity principle for NEPSR, use it or lose it. Failure to drive brain functions lead to functional degeneration. Use it and improve it. Training that drives a specific brain function enhances that function. Specificity. Nature of training experience dictates the plasticity. Repetition and intensity matters. Induction of plasticity required sufficient repetition and intensity. Salience matter. Training must be salient enough to induce plasticity. Multisensory interaction. Brains simultaneously process and integrate numerous inputs. Enriched environment. Interactive environment induce better plasticity. So intervention was imparted in sequence of four levels. Level one include neural activation with mirror therapy and sensory imaging. Level two includes active sensory training with bimanual sensory training. Level three includes sensory motor therapy with specific stimuli. Level four includes sensory functional therapy using various shapes, size, and textured object. Training was provided as per sensory impairments and corresponding motor recovery stage. So, for example, for light touch, BRS level 1 and 2, we provide level 1 mirror therapy. For pressure, BRS level 3, we provide level 2 bilateral and unilateral play, and so goes on. These are some of the videos of light touch and pressure intervention. These are the videos of stereognosis and proprioception intervention, where we provide different objects and the objects have different sort of textures. So intervention, the dosage was 40 sessions, 5 per week, 2 hours for 8 weeks. In addition to NEPSR protocol, standard rehab was provided based on neurophysiological and biomechanical approaches. Outcome measures, feasibility was assessed for acceptability, adherence, and safety. Primary outcome measure is Fugle-Meyer assessment upper extremity, Erasmus MC modification of revised Nottingham sensory assessment, Nottingham sensory assessment stereognosis. All the measures exhibit adequate reliability and validity. Secondary outcome measures were semi-western monofilament, two-point discrimination, and modified ranking scale. Data analysis. Being the feasibility study, no specific statistical test was applied. Aspect of feasibility was assessed subjectively. Pre and post intervention change were computed in the form of mean plus minus SD and N percentage. Line diagrams were plotted to observe the trend of change pre and post intervention. These are the demographic data. Average age was 51 years. Average time since stroke was 6 months. Male were 7 and female were 3. Ischemic were 6 and hemorrhagic were 4. Right side involvement were 6 and left side involvement were 4. Feasibility in acceptability. Subject were able to perceive texture and could identify object with or without vision. They were satisfied and interested to continue the protocol. Adherence. Subjects were required to be attentive during the protocol. All participants attended 2 hours of session without missing a single day. Safety, no adverse event reported in the in any of the session, such as uneasiness during blindfold, rashes, bruises, and injury. So the average FMA UE score were improved from 22 to 31. The average FMA wrist and hand improves from 4 to 8. EMS NSA improved from 21 to 33. And component of EM NSA improves in all the subcategories. SWM reduced from 0.695 to 0.408. 2PD reduced from 8 to 4. MRS13 is pre-intervention is 8, while in the post-intervention it's 9. MRS4 and 5 are in pre-intervention is 2, whereas in the post-intervention is 1. Somatosensory impairment also need to be discussed, also need to be intervened in the stroke rehabilitation. NEPSER or novel protocol has been found to be feasible for post-stroke subjects. The protocol has components for enhancing sensory as well as motor deficits. NEPSER protocol is formulated with structured dosage of sensory-based motor tasks to exploit the neural linkage of sensory-motor brain areas. Crucial component of this protocol are frequency and intensity, motor recovery stage, chronicity, management of specific sensory deficit. Repetitive sensory activity with motor participation could be the reason for the change in FMA UE and EMNSA. Positive change in all the motor and sensory item could also be attributed to the neural-based mechanism of mirror therapy. Mirror therapy-based activity may activate somatosensory cortex and interhemispheric communication. Somatosensation play an important role in fine hand function and coordination. CNS supports the proper execution of movements by comparing sensory inputs. Sensory retraining facilitates cerebral cortex for adapting the movements. Limitations were participants with lower motor stage were initially not able to perform the sensory activities. Lack of higher motor recovery stage subjects. Provision of score for subjects who have responded to SWM 2PD were not available. NEPSER conclusion. NEPSER protocol is a feasibility regime in stroke. Sensory motor recovery can be enhanced by incorporating the protocol. Sensory intervention should also be incorporated in stroke rehabilitation. Further trials were needed to study the effectiveness in this novel intervention. These are my references. I would like to acknowledge ICMR New Delhi for funding, HODOT and Director PDU and IPPD for permitting to conduct the study. Thank you.
It was a good presentation and innovative idea. Nice presentation, Akshay.
Thank you, sir.
Now, is there any question for Akshay?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Shomya Kant or Dr. Srihas?
Was there a carry over?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Into ADL.
Sorry, sir.
The audience has asked, was there a carryover of the achieved function to ADL?
Sir, ADL is not in our outcome measures, but we have assessed in informal way.
Okay.
We have a separate sort of clinical form in which we have also assessed ADL. Through Pathal index.
Okay, that's nice. Is there any further questions or we can proceed for next presentation?
Sir, I think we can proceed for the next presentation.
Okay. So for the 8th presentation in this session, I would like to call upon Dr. Prabhakar N. Madkayarkar. The topic of the presentation is effectiveness of occupational therapy along with coping strategy on auditory hallucination and occupational therapy functioning in schizophrenia. This presentation is under a competitive category. Dr. Prabhakar, I would request you to start your presentation now.
Dr. Prabhakar is not in the panelist in this group.
Okay. So now we can request the Shali sir to come upon. Now for faculty talk. So today in this faculty talk, we have a very senior and esteemed occupational therapist with us. He is a PhD, DBA, MSc, Diploma in OT, PGDR, PGCE, TDIP, COT, FACOT. He has 40 years of working experience in the health and social care sector. He started his teaching career in 1977 in UK at Glasgow School of Occupational Therapy. He has 23 years of experience in Hong Kong Polytechnic University. He has published many publications in journals. He has appointed by the chief executive of Hong Kong Special Administrative Region of the People's Republic of China as a Justice of Peace on 1st July 2002. He received IOTA Lifetime Achievement Award in 2013. He is presently serving as lecturer at the Robert Gordon University in Everton, UK. So I welcome Bhumira Dashari, sir. I know him very well. Age is just the number for him, and he is a very dynamic and energetic person. I have seen in all the conferences, he participates with full energy and interest. Bhumira Dasari, sir, please, you are welcome. And may I request to keep your presentation little short because we are too late today. Thank you, sir.
Can I just say, can I bring my greetings from UK to everybody?
Yes.
This is the title of my presentation, Teaching and Learning of Anatomy Online During the COVID-19 Pandemic. What are the issues and challenges? First of all, very interesting that why I chose this topic. Originally, I wanted to do it, my video presentations of my anatomy. Unfortunately, my university did not approve because the human body is part of the Human Tissue Authority. So it is governed by the Human Tissue Act. So therefore, I have to change my presentation, and only I'm using what are the issues and challenges. Now, what I'm going to cover in this presentation is, first of all, as an introduction, I'm setting the scene. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the aims of my presentation, some pertinent literature, very brief. The very interesting thing I want to show you, I've taken two examples. One from the Chinese medical schools, another one from UK medical schools. Now, the reason I've taken these two schools to see that what is happening, the anatomy around the world, and the coronavirus started in China. So we are looking at the Chinese medical schools and what are the new learning strategies and digital technology. And I will end my presentation with the concluding remarks. Everything is okay, Sriharsh?
Yes, it is okay, sir.
So the aim of my presentation is to discuss the challenges and opportunities faced by the medical and healthcare students in implementing online teaching of anatomy during the time of COVID-19 pandemic crisis. Explore the new innovative strategies to integrate digital technology for the teaching of anatomy remotely during COVID, to address some of the students and teachers' concern about online teaching in UK and Chinese medical schools. By the way, you all must have read in my introduction, I have been teaching anatomy for the last more than 40 years. So this is my favorite subject. Now, the study of the human anatomy has historically held a strong, predictable, and important place in the allied health curricula and is considered as an integral component in the education of future occupational therapists. I don't have to tell this to the distinguished audience, because most of you all sitting in the audience are having more than 40, 50 years of experience, and they may have done the anatomy, maybe like me, I have done 50 years ago. But as an important, we must mention that it is the important aspect of the OT curriculum, anatomy. Now, the medical and healthcare schools are currently facing the biggest challenge. And this is creating for the training of the allied health and medical students within the limitation of social distancing due to the suspension of practical and the lab sessions. Now, additionally, the education of health professionals starts with a good grounding in basic sciences, which are meant to impart students with a good understanding of the structure and function of the human body. I am sure you all agree, everybody, about this statement. Anatomical knowledge and understanding are key components of occupational therapy education and practice. Additionally, anatomy has been taught as a foundation stream within the first years of occupational therapy education. The United Kingdom, because that's where really I'm based in and where I worked, most of the universities and the medical schools have suspended face-to-face by the 17th March. And this is the same thing worldwide, forcing students to move to online distance learning for indefinite future. The use of remote learning as an emergency measure has affected staff, students, faculty, support, and the administrators alike. The effect of coronavirus has had on people's daily lives is clearly like nothing most people have experienced before. One of the many affected sectors is education, of course, you all agree. UNESCO also reported that around 61 countries were enforcing closure of higher education institutes in Africa, Asia, Europe, Middle East, and America's countries. As a result of COVID-19 pandemic, medical and healthcare education resulted in the suspension of face-to-face teaching across the world. How is the, Sriharsh, everything is clear?
So everything is
going to hear me?
So basically you will not be able to see the audience because we are on live in the auditorium.
No, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you completely.
Okay. Clearly.
Yes.
Despite the advances in technology that allow for online distance learning, acquiring anatomical knowledge in the laboratory, ideally through cadaveric dissection, is often still regarded as not only a rite of passage, but also the most effective method of learning. Now, this is still at the moment debated whether the use of cadavers or not because of the technology. The disappearance of practical teaching at the hands of COVID-19, regardless of whether students normally receive cadaveric teaching or not, will most likely have many lasting impacts on students. New innovative strategies are emerging in anatomy teaching that incorporate technology, making learning more interactive, student-centered, and more appealing to the student's body. Traditional dissection is being substituted by novel modalities like prosection, mannequin models, plastinated specimens, problem-based learning, and computer-assisted learning. But this is where I want to take you through the study. First is the perception of medical students towards online teaching toward the COVID-19 pandemic. It is a national cross-sectional survey of 2,721 UK medical students. Is a large, large students population. This is one study. This is a public, this is the very latest one, 2020. Another one is a gross anatomy education China during the COVID-19 pandemic. It is a national survey. I'm sure that everybody will be very interested to know because of the coronavirus, where it is started. So let us now begin and look at quickly, I want to take you just a snapshot. What is the objective of this study? It's to investigate perception of medical students and the role of online teaching in facilitating medical education during the COVID-19 pandemic. And the design of this study is a cross-sectional online national survey. And the settings is responses collected online from 14th May to the 11th May, is only about a week. Who are the prospects medical students across all year from UK registered medical schools? I can tell you 40 medical schools participated and the 2,721 students. And what are the outcome measures are? The uses, experiences, perceived benefits, and barriers of online teaching during the COVID pandemic. So you have about 4 or 5 outcome measures. What are the results? 2,071 medical students across 39 medical schools responded. One did not respond, originally was 40. Medical schools adapted to the pandemic in different ways. I don't want to take you through that because of the time shortage. The changes include in the development of new distance learning platforms on which content was released. Another one, remote delivery of lectures using platforms and the use of question banks and other online activity call resources. What were the results like? Pay attention here. A significant difference was found between time spent on online platforms before and during the COVID-19 with 7.5% of students. That is about 200 students out of 2,000 before versus this 24% students. Remember, these are all 2,700 of 24% during the pandemic spending more than 15 hours per week. That is very significant. The greatest perceived benefits of online teaching platforms included their flexibility, because you are working at home, so you have a flexible time, whereas the commonly perceived barriers using online teaching platforms, including family distraction and poor internet connection. The conclusions from the study: online teaching has enabled the continuation of medical education during these unprecedented times. Moving forward from the pandemic, in order to maximize the benefits, both face-to-face and online teaching, and to improve the efficacy of medical education in the future, we suggest medical faculty to resort to teaching formats such as team-based and problem-based learning. The use of online teaching platforms allowing students to digest information in their own time, but also allow students to then constructively discuss the material with the peers. I don't try to take you through the graphs because of the time, but you can see that everything is presented systematically. All the data has been collected. I can only show you one. Look at the video tutorials here. This one, very high. Almost more than 2,025 students or online platform were using video tutorials here. Very high percentage. This, I will skip this one again. As you can see, the dark color is during the pandemic and the one without filling is before pandemic. So you can see this, is during the pandemic. The people are using more time on that because they're spending more time. So this was using the manual U-test, showing the students were during the pandemic was very significant at point, you can see 001, very high. These are the perception of the students that experience online teaching. I don't want to show you, but you can see the high students here. Teachers are well prepared for the teaching sessions. That's very good. I would like to online teaching to be more interactive. This is what the students are saying. I feel able to ask the questions I want. That's a good positive point. The teaching is often stimulating. These are some of the perceptions of the students on their study. Now this is we look at just China. What is happening again? That was in UK medical schools. According to the Chinese Minister of Education, there are 128 medical schools in China, if anybody interested. That includes two in Hong Kong, and one in Macau. During the pandemic, use of online courses in Chinese medical schools started in February 2020. That's what when the coronavirus started in China. So they already started way ahead. So what they wanted to study, they wanted to evaluate the gross anatomy in Chinese medical schools, and they did a nationwide survey they conducted by using through convenient sampling and also by email and respondent invitation on social media. The survey found that before the pandemic, this is interesting, 74% of the medical schools were using theoretical course, whereas 34% of the medical schools were using practical sessions before the pandemic. These are the 77 medical schools here. So 36 medical schools had temporarily suspended practical sessions at the time of the survey. What are the conclusions from their studies? The survey found that a significant number of medical schools in China already had experience in online teaching, which enabled fast deployment of online learning during the pandemic. However, some schools chose to suspend their practical sessions during the pandemic. The difficulties outlined by teachers in the survey provide insight into the obstacles to the development of gross anatomy education in China. Anatomy China should start forward planning as how to overcome these obstacles because the duration of the pandemic is unknown. During the pandemic, 40% of the 77 medical schools kept or initiated the implementation of active learning, and online assessment was continued in 40% of the 77 medical schools. Another 26 of the medical school initiated online assessment during the pandemic. A total of 360 questionnaires were received from 77 schools representing online mainland China as well as Hong Kong, Macau. This is interesting here. Before the pandemic, 74% of the 77 schools conducted theoretical course, whereas 34% were using practical sessions on gross anatomy. 47% of the 77 schools temporarily suspended practical sessions at the time of survey. This you can see, we'll skip some of the thing. Most important thing, teachers' perception of online teaching experience. 315 answers were included in the analysis. That's a quite high. Nearly half of the teachers were satisfied with the effective online teaching. Pay attention here, 50% teachers. They are happy with that. 36% of the teacher online teaching, they're happy to teach theoretical, whereas 89 teachers were keen to return traditional face-to-face anatomy. Now they want to go back to the face-to-face. That's no practical. Now, again, I don't want to show you that there are so many graphs here. Don't know the moderator, how much time do I have? So they're all represented graphically.
So we can we wind up in next 5 minutes? 5 to 12.
5 minutes, okay, that's good to know, thank you. So I will skip through all these. Everything is properly done, statistically analyzed, everything, because I've already given you a snapshot in the beginning of the results and everything. This is the interesting here. So qualitative analysis of teachers' comments. This is, you should look at it with representative quotes. I will only take you a few quotes. The theme, number one, is the demands in learning technology. What are the teachers were saying? Hopefully, the prestigious medical schools could share their online teaching resource because they have experience. Collaboration is the most in demand currently to optimize the anatomy education. I think this is, we all agree here, same thing happens in UK schools. So that is a very fair comment from the teacher. So second theme is evaluation on online teaching. Within the evaluation, they wanted to talk about acknowledgement of anatomical teaching online, and they want to emphasize the indispensability of practical sessions. Now, there's quite a good comment. These are the usually 141 cases out of 35, these 32%, these world, they say online education could be beneficial, supplement for face-to-face teaching, and facilitate the students to learn at different paces. Online teaching has no problem in theoretical session. Please keep in mind that lab training is an indispensable part of anatomy education. I'm sure I already say that because the cadaver dissection without that is very, very difficult to know what exactly the anatomy. So that's why they're saying practical lab is one of the best. We should go back. The other thing for future teachers, what are they saying? Suggestion for future online teaching. We should open lab for the medical students who are studying anatomy with face-to-face class resume, even if they would have finished anatomy course at that time. They still want to go back to face-to-face. Online teaching platforms greatly facilitate the homework assignment and as well as environment friendly, so it should be used more often. I think, again, some of the teachers, what they are saying about online teaching. Now remember, these are the 77 medical schools and these are the theoretical in this one and the practical. So I will only take blended teaching with combination of online teaching. Blended means both combination of face-to-face and also the practical. So 25 out of 77 schools, 32%, they are saying theoretical sessions, and 51% agree because the practical sessions are very, very important. So anatomy without practical is not very good. Then other thing that they're saying, mixed synchronous, asynchronous, good again, 27, 35% theoretical, 16% per practical, suspended and will make up the missed lesson after the pandemic. Now, 36 people, they want to go back to the practical, but theoretical, they don't want it. That's interesting. Now, I will skip you another, I will only take opportunities. Usually this is not an important one, probably. We'll look at this one. Now, we all know that technology has taken much of the strain. Institutions have used web pages, emails, texts, social media platforms to inform students of the ever-changing situation. We all agree that. At the same time, teaching has mostly been delivered remotely through virtual learning environments, cloud-based communication and collaboration platforms. Nothing can be impaired. As you can see, this entire conference is now based on a virtual learning environments, and we all appreciate how interesting these platforms are. So the same thing, we include replacing physical lectures with a recorded video presentations. This is one thing I wanted to bring it lively, but I was rejected by the university that did not allow me. Providing live sessions, case-based tutorials via the Zoom, Google Meet, Microsoft Teams, Blackboard, all these things we are now using it, and pre-existing digital anatomy learning resources. Some of these things, unfortunately, I could not bring it to show you, but that's another problem. So another thing, cadaver dissection and prosection, which consists of traditional method of teaching, have become increasingly difficult due to lack of donated bodies, increasing concerns over safety, significant expenses. Furthermore, rising cost of cadaveric availability, health, rise of formalin, psycho-religious bias. I don't know whether you agree with that. I find Muslim students in my class, a lot of difficult Chinese students we had, they were very religious. They were not going to touch the bones. There were a lot of problems. Anyway, lack of trained personal, time constraints. These are common with anatomy. I'm sure everybody have gone through when you're all students. Mixed method of teaching and learning in the current pandemic are clearly encouraged, including instructional dissection videos where students can watch pre-recorded dissection. And even the appropriate YouTube anatomy, Auckland's anatomy, all videos are very, very helpful for the students. This is a very important point, students' concern. The transition from on-campus medical school settings to home environment is likely to result in isolation, causing stress. Those who are students in this listening can all agree with me, causing stress, lack of concentration, reduced interaction with peers they can't see, and family disturbances. Besides, students' anatomy learning continue. The pandemic also raised issues like cohort anatomy students' future. They are worried, what is going to happen to me? And clinical understanding and appreciation for the relevance of anatomy might also suffer due to the current pandemic because of the loss of practical training in the anatomy lab. So I will only close with one conclusion, important probably. This is the one. In my mind, the current students are the healthcare leaders of tomorrow. And this pandemic ought to have an impact, not just on their education and training, but also possibly on their future careers. Although too early to understand its full impact on students, the COVID-19 pandemic might lead to an increased interest in students opting to specialize in specialties like leading to areas such as public health, nursing, allied health like us, or acute medicine in the future, or else it might have a negative impact with students opting out of the medical profession. Nevertheless, only time will tell. These are quite a lot of references. Thank you very much.
That was really, really extensive. I can see you put in so much of efforts, and I hope that most of the delegates, student delegates especially, have seen this. And also the faculty of other colleges have seen this. And we should convey this topic and presentation to our anatomy lecturers and professors. This was wonderful, and thank you so much for dedicating your time and teaching us, and always keep learning. And I cannot thank you enough on behalf of scientific committee of OTCON 2021, on behalf of President Sir, Vice President Sir, Secretary, and Organizing Secretary Jyotika Bijlani. Thank you so much, sir. It was wonderful having you.
Thank you. I lost words how to express, but you've been wonderful. You all been wonderful audience. Thank you. Sorry, in the very beginning, technology not always not a problem.
You are not giving up attitude is really so much inspiring. I'm sure people in the auditorium must have watched you and seen your efforts put in the presentation.
Can I say a few words?
Yes.
First of all, wholeheartedly, I would like to thank the scientific committee. Wholeheartedly, it has gone into much. All this is the whole thing. These virtual learning platforms as the biggest challenge. The IOTA conference did very well. Our president, Dr. Anil Srivastava, is dedicated team. Everybody worked behind the scenes. I don't know. This is a great occasion. First virtual live conference is a great success. Very good success. I want to really thank everybody wholeheartedly.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
You can.
Yes, sir.
We thank both our chairpersons for today, Dr. Amitabh Dwivedi sir and Dr. Jagdishan sir. Thank you for rendering your valuable time to this session, and it was very enlightening. Sir, would you like to summarize the session, Amitabh sir and Jagdishan sir?
Yes, sir. Amitabh sir, shall I start, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, sir. So I thanks IOTA for providing us such a great opportunity. This is the first virtual conference, wonderfully going on. I thank the scientific committee and the presenters. All presenters of this session 5 were presented very well. They have given very innovative ideas to our young people, those who are attending. That is, I am mentioning the students. And this virtual platform is always challenging one, but for our conference, it is very nicely going on. So I thank all the scientific committee people, in specific with Lakshman sir, Srigar sir, Samyukant, and I thank my chairperson, Dr. Amitabh, for this wonderful session. Thank you again.
Amitabh sir, you want to conclude?
Yeah, I just want to say that all the 8 papers were very nice, and some of paper like review and even the bladder control and behavioral intention, it all the good paper has been presented, and it was very practical for the all of us. And I want to give thanks to President IOTA, Accord Dean Jyotika Madam, and Scientific Chairperson Lakshman, Dr. Sihas, and this Soumyakant Sahu for organizing it very nicely, and it was very effective. And in this COVID period, the virtual is really, really a new thing for us. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to chair this session. Thank you very much.
It was our pleasure indeed, sir. Have a nice day.